attending by. So first, let me introduce myself. My name is Arnav. I'm studying in 9th grade. I started computers when I was in 4th grade. So my father gave me exposure in different activities, such as the badges, swimming, chess, karate, and so on. And then finally, I concluded in computer science. So my father actually suggested me on learning C and C++ in the beginning. So I did my diploma in C and C++ in Coimbatore IB. Then I did it. These are some of the projects that I did during my Google TensorFlow for stopping the depletion of coral reefs in Great Barrier Reef, Australia. Then I made an AI-based software application which uses reinforcement learning to pass game data to play chess and then a level 5 autopilot. Currently all cars are in level 4 where you have to keep supervising your car, but in level 5 it's, there won't be any error or mistake. I did a simulation using Kotla. It's an open source library for Python and R. Then I did a website evaluation using user's opinion. So this takes it using feedback to give us a better experience, to like, give us feedback based on like how can my website be better or do that. Then I made assessment prediction for social media. In my case, I used Twitter. So this is my Twitter link. You can visit this to know more about these projects. So now let's get into the topic. What is artificial intelligence? Does somebody have an idea of like what artificial intelligence is? Anybody can share your points. So I'll just continue. So before getting into the topic, let me make something clear. There's a misconception that robots are artificial intelligence, which is false. Robots are pre-coded agents which use commands to do their actions, where AI takes in a small data set, takes in data to give it output in a particular form, in form of clustering, regression, classification, and so on. So what is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is a study of intelligent agents or models who take in a particular output, in particular there is an output. So there are three under artificial intelligence, we have machine learning and deep learning. So here we have multiple algorithms or concrete models such as decision tree and forest deep learning, which we'll be talking about in the upcoming slides. So let's dig deep into artificial intelligence history. So if artificial intelligence, the history of artificial intelligence. So the term artificial AI was coined in the year 1956 by John McCarthy. So he had a hobby of converting human actions into machine code or machine algorithms, which led him to creating AI. So he first introduced this topic in his conference based on this topic. And now, as we're talking about Alan Turing, he's a British computer scientist who discovered the Turing test. The Turing test helps us evaluate and know about how well a machine can think and communicate. So let's see how this works. The Turing test has multiple unseen guests. So one of the guests is replaced by a machine or an AI model. So even by switching a guest bar with machine, if the results of the talk show or any game show going on is unchanged, that means the AI, it has enough knowledge to communicate with human beings and is useful in the society and can be used for commercial purposes. So that's how the Turing test works. Even now, this the Turing test takes place in a lot of competitions. So according to a lot of archaeologists and historians, art of AI have been existing since 700 BCE. So in Greece, according to a lot of inscriptions, texts, and etc., there was this golden humanoid called Talos in ancient Greece. So according to a lot of Romans, this ancient humanoid could do all human actions. what machine learning is. Machine learning gives machines the ability to think. So we give machine learning a particular input to when we expect output in form of classification, regression, clustering, and etc. So some of the algorithms which are under machine learning are some of the subsidiaries of machine learning are supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So why supervised learning? Supervised learning is a substitute of machine learning where we have labeled data as an input and we expect for a particular output. So let me give you an example. Now I'm going to a school. I have teachers who will see teachers or supervisors will help me label the data, which is a book, for example, which has a lot of content in it. So that's how like supervised learning works, and then we have unsupervised learning. So unsupervised learning is also a subsidiary of machine learning, where we don't have labeled data. So let me give you an example. So I have a book, but I don't have a supervisor or teacher who would help me label the data or label the important contents from the book. That's how unsupervised learning works. So some of the algorithms that we use in unsupervised learning are mostly based out of clustering, which is also known as categorizing. Some algorithms are k-means, c-means, clustering, and etc. Then we have reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is not used in commercial purposes comparatively to supervised and unsupervised learning due to its less accuracy, because in supervised learning we actually don't give the model data. Rather, we let it interact with an environment using the Markov decision process which will be looking in the COVID-19. Because we do not have any previous data based on this virus, and without the use of reinforcement learning, it would have preparing a vaccine would have taken years, if not decades. So let's look at some algorithms which are used in machine learning. First, we look at decision tree. Decision tree is a subsidiary of supervised machine learning technique. So here, the computer goes through a set of questions, which is known as the decision tree nodes. So when it goes through a lot of decision node, the final solution is given in form of a leaf node. So let me give an example to make it clear. For example, now I input a data, and let's say the first question is that what is the shape of the data, or like what is the shape of the image which is given as an input. Now, like there are two choices. Is it circle, square, or irregular? So let's say according to our model, a concrete model, it goes to circle. And then that means the AI comes up with another set of questions, which is that, like, what is the color of the image? Is it orange, is it red, or is it some other color? So if it goes to orange, now we are able to categorize that this machine, image data is an orange or it's a ball. So that's how this decision tree algorithm works. It is mostly used for the purpose of categorizing or in prediction cases. Now let's look at random forest. So here in this name might ring a bell with the last algorithm for you. Let me tell you that both of them are extremely similar. Now you might have a doubt, like why would I use random forest when I already have decision tree? Now let me give you an example. I have a decision tree model which is already running, as I said you. Now if I change a small data in it in my input, it might change the whole structure of my decision tree model. So now we can conclude that the decision tree model is very sensitive to data changes and cannot be used for generalization purposes. That's where random forest comes in, where we have multiple decision tree models at once, and using name is, first we input the data and k variable, mostly k is a constant in this case. So in a graph, these k variable has a data set or listed them. So in a graph, these lists are randomly placed in form of centroids. So we have to draw a line across the graph to find the nearest centroid to the line. So the centroids that are near to the line are a cluster of the line, or let's say the line has x. So what we have to do is we have to keep repositioning the line to get the most amount of clusters. So where is this mostly used? This is used in case of solving breast cancer, pancreatic cancer, weight problems, a lot of healthcare industries. Now let's take a look at reinforcement learning based algorithm, Q learning. Here Q stands for quality. So why is Q learning used? Q learning is mostly used in gaming fields, as we are not used for commercial purposes. Let me give a quick look at what Q learning is. Q learning is model free algorithm. What is the meaning of model free? We don't have a concrete algorithm in this case. The algorithm keeps switching models according to the interaction with the environment. So let's say we have a game going on. Now, what is the use of Q-learning? Q-learning helps us best interact with the environment where the agent is. Who is the agent? Agent is a main model which works in the environment to give us results. So the environment should have certain important functions, such as it should have a reward, a time delay, a lot of required. So this comes under the Markov's decision process. It's an algorithm which lists out all the available parameters in the Q learning application. So that's how Q learning works. So this is, as I said, is not used in commercial purposes. So Google made, like in 2018, Google in collaboration with MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, US, made a small walking AI which learned to walk on its own. Now, if you don't believe, through a lot of trial and error method, it's able to cross hurdles and etc. Now, let's take a quick look at what deep learning is. Deep learning is also a subsidiary of machine learning and artificial intelligence, where data is mostly in form of neural networks. So deep learning is mostly in form of neural networks which have more than two or more hidden layers. Is where all the processing work is done. In neural network, we mostly have an input layer, hidden layer, and then output layer. So, why deep learning? Deep learning helps us to process large amount of data. So, deep learning mostly works in the form of a brain, which helps it learn AI for medical purposes. Using neural networks and deep learning, now AI is able to take on a lot of delicate surgeries, such as removal of tumor and cancer. But as some of the dependencies of AI, uses of AI in our daily society. AI helps in people from below poverty line. So I am in collaboration with a lot of freelance workers created this satellite-based imaging project which detects lumps in some areas to make those people, those poor people, employment opportunities and work with other services. So this project is actually running in Brazil and Argentina, as Brazil has one of the largest lump areas in the world. Then AI helps in aircraft aviation. So one and app is created in artificial intelligence-based algorithm, which helps correct manual deviations. Now, through a lot of trial and error method, this project is able to aviate a plane on its own. Then AI helps any other. AI has been helping in a lot of primary industries, such as car manufacturing, aircraft manufacturing, and etc. AI in the field of education. So you remember that AI, a lot of new LMS softwares are coming up. For example, we have Byju's, Vedanta, etc. These LMS softwares take in our previous learning data to give us better form of education in form of activities, lectures, etc. Then we have AI healthcare. As I said before, AI is now able to perform a lot of delicate surgery, not possible even by humans 10 years ago. So, and then AI helps in finance. So AI has been existing in finance for a very long time. In fact, finance was the first field where AI opportunity took place. So we have Robin Hood, they created CIT.AI, which helps in detecting the 50-50 companies in stock trade and helps a lot of stock traders. So let's look at some recent advances of artificial intelligence in our society. Quantum AI. So Google created Quantum AI in the year 2018. It was actually bought by Quantum AI Engine. So what is Quantum AI? So according to a lot of Google-based research, Quantum AI is able to create applications on its own to use machine-less means, so which was not possible in normal computers. It is due to the computational advantage. It's because in quantum AI, in quantum computing, we have fluid equations, while in normal computers, we just have a switch. If the switch goes on, it's 1, and if the switch goes off, it's 0. It's binary code, is what I'm trying to mention. But in quantum AI, we have fluid consistency, where there are infinite number of values. So the quantum, the AI is able to make multiple choices at once. AI chips, which are created by Google, AI chips help support advances in artificial intelligence-based projects. So now a lot of companies are turning away from coffee processors to a lot of AI chips. So why AI chips? AI chips come in a very low price with high processing speed. Now, even with a costly processor, we won't be able to do some deep learning-based algorithms. That's because these processors are not majorly designed for building AI-based projects. While these chips have a formulated method where we can use it mainly for deep learning, that should be fast. We have to supervise the model. So AI model always goes through a lot of trial and error method. So their supervisation is required. Then you have to